Good evening. My name is Bill McGraw, and I'm the president of the Vancouver Linux Users Group. Tonight we have with us Micheal Vonn. Micheal is a security, privacy, and policing expert. She's no stranger to VanLug. Previously she spoke to us about the importance of personal identifiers, and tonight she's going to speak to us about the government's new policing and national security legislation and the consultation process that goes with it. She is the policy director of the BC Civil Liberties Association, and she's frequently consulted by the national media. She is an advisory board member of Privacy International and Ryerson University's Center for Free Expression. She is currently a collaborator on big data surveillance, a multi-year international research project led by Queen's University. So can we give Ms. Vonn a warm welcome?
Thank you very much. I'll take the microphone from you. Thank you kindly.
I'll give you the entire stage.
Oh, thanks lots. Nice to be here. So when Bill was asking me what I thought were the sort of top issues, what's going on, he said, in the world of civil liberties and privacy and such, I said, well, big news. Canada is having an unprecedented, we've never done this before, national security consultation, a nationwide consultation of citizens and experts alike on the national security framework for Canada. Now, why would we be doing such a thing? Well, in the main, we're doing such a thing because of the controversial Bill C-51. Highly contentious, large protests all over the country in relation to Bill C-51. Of course, Bill C-51 we still refer to as such. It is no longer a bill, it is the law. It enacted the Anti-Terrorism Act 2015, but nobody knows it as that. Everyone still calls it Bill C-51. And they remember that this was really an unprecedented and radical expansion of national security legislation and policy in Canada. We'd never seen anything quite like it. And when the current government came in, they had made some promises, particularly around, if you will, sort of shaving off the most controversial aspects or the most problematic aspects, at any rate, of Bill C-51. They have done no amendments at this juncture. They have launched a consultation, a part of which is to look at those provisions that were brought in. And while they were at it, they wanted to talk about a whole bunch of other things too. So in the main, they have put together their discussion in a paper that I noticed that Bill brought, a green paper, so-called, a backgrounder on national security in Canada. My organization, a little bit concerned about how some of the framing was going down in the government's view, has been publishing incrementally a blog series called A Different Shade of Green Paper, where we're covering most of the issues that the government is covering from a slightly more rights protective angle. Right? Here are some things that they forgot to mention, for example, dot, dot, dot. But what I thought you might be particularly interested in has to do not only with the components of Bill C-51 that most impact digital communications, but the new proposals for digital communications, particularly digital investigations that are part of the government's discussion. Some of those are pretty controversial, and they've been increasingly controversial in part because the Toronto Star and the CBC did a joint series called Going Dark, a series of investigative reporting about the RCMP in the main, but many police organizations in Canada, looking to expand their investigative powers. And there is a fundamental, if you will, sort of rift in the country about whether police and their ability to track us, particularly online, are indeed going dark, as they would put it, or as privacy advocates would put it, are we really in a golden age of surveillance? See, for example, CSIS illegally collecting metadata, et cetera, et cetera. So that kind of schism is pretty rife in terms of the difference between how the government is framing things and how advocates and allies of advocates have been making submissions. So as I say, those are the things that I thought would be particularly interesting. Now that doesn't mean that there any aspect of national security or Bill C-51 is off the table. So that includes everything from no-fly lists to terrorist speech offenses to the whole raft of what was introduced in this, again, really radical reconfiguring of our national security landscape. Another aspect of the discussion has to do with how do we keep national security agents accountable, right? Accountability is like the word of the moment in this consultation, right? In part because national security, what makes national security so dangerous from a democratic perspective, is that it's not ordinary crime. National security denotes some aspect of a state of exception. Ordinary crime, we develop ordinary crime-fighting tools for. National security argues that the imperative, their mandate, is such that they need to conduct a great deal of their work in secret. So that presents, again, a real democratic challenge. How do you trust the operation of entities that work in secret? What is allowed to be secret? One of the distinctions that we've made, for example, is to say, well, of course, there could be operational aspects of what you're doing as an intelligence gathering agency that might need to be secret. But you better not be operating on the basis of secret laws. We need to be able to assess this framework in order to say whether these powers are proportionate, necessary, and really if we can abide by them in a free and democratic society. So how to keep the organizations accountable has been a big piece of this discussion. And while we've been having this discussion, the consultation was launched in September and officially ends Wednesday. So anybody can get in a submission before Wednesday. They will accept them. Email, send in what you have to say, fill out the form, send in, you know, whatever you like. There's been a component of this that's almost been ironic, because while we've been doing this consultation, there's been a series of news stories breaking with national security scandal after national security scandal, right? So we've got the scandal of spying on journalists in Quebec. We have the explosion with a federal court case that found that CSIS, which are domestic intelligence, CSIS has been illegally collecting metadata, digital metadata on telecommunications of Canadians for 10 years. Not only have they been doing that, but they've sought warrants for those, but they haven't told the judge the things that they were supposed to get the warrant. So the federal court judges have essentially, take your pick, what kind of word you want to use, lied to, misinformed, not having completed all of the necessary and requisite informational structures, however you want to say this, they did not give the appropriate information to the court. And the court found them in breach of their duty of candor. Right? So 10 years worth of data collected in breach of the obligations you have to ask the judge, can I get this? What can I do with this? Is this okay? So the judge said, yes, these warrants were issued, but on faulty information, right? 10 years worth of that. Then we find out, again, as part of this litany of scandals that goes on, that there's an oversight body for the intelligence agents, domestic intelligence, CSIS. There's an oversight body called CERC. And CERC did their first ever audits of what is in the CSIS bulk data holdings. So metadata is not the only bulk data that they've been collecting. And when we say bulk data, we obviously mean data on rafts of Canadians. They've been ingesting somebody's databases. We don't know which databases, other than the metadata, but they have an entire bulk data holdings. And CERC did their first ever audit of those holdings, and what they found was no evidence to suggest that they were abiding by the appropriate legal restrictions. No evidence to suggest the application of the appropriate legal standard. Now, there's no other way to read that. Again, CERC won't tell you what's in those databases. This is all secret. But between the federal court decision on the breach of the duty of candor and the illegally acquired metadata, and CERC's report saying that they have failed to apply the applicable standard, it is possible that every single piece of data in the CSIS bulk data holdings is illegal. Every single one. None of it legally acquired. Their standard in their act is that they are not to collect data unless it is strictly necessary. And that's the standard they have failed to apply. Which again, you think, that makes sense that that is difficult to do with bulk data holdings. How do you argue that every piece of data that you acquire in an ingested database is strictly necessary to your mandate to investigate threats to the national security of Canada? But most of what we're seeing around this sort of pattern of illegality in the national security realm pertains to bulk data. So really what we're talking about, the discussion that is nowhere in the Green Paper, very frustratingly, is should we, because they only want bulk data for one thing, analytics, right? They want to do analytics. They want to profile. They want to do networking. They want to do all the analytics that you can do with bulk data on a population-based level.
And then what they do with it?
Well, one of the things that we know that they do with it, there are many things we don't know what they do with it, but one of the things that we do know happens when you go to the airport, right? It is possible that you could be in Canada on what is called a no-fly list, meaning that they have data, and we think that human sources are involved for most of that data, that the minister and say, this is our recommendation, this person not be able to fly, get on an airplane. That's one aspect of the no-fly regime that we have. The other aspect is what I call slow fly, which is, yes, you can get on an airplane, but you are subjected to increased security scrutiny. And to be on the slow fly list, that's just analytics. That's algorithmic. I don't know which databases that they're querying, but certainly they're looking at where you go in the world and what other aspects of your religious, racial makeup of whatever kind, what other networking data that they have, who you know and where you've been. Don't know which databases go in to make up those data holdings that are queried, but that would be definitely example. We already know this from CBSA, the Canada Border Services Agency. They say, yes, we do analytics on certain data that we will not disclose, and on the basis of that, we decide profiling, who's a risk, right?
Yeah, may I ask a question?
Go ahead. No. We're a nice, homey place for discussion. Well, you certainly need computers to employ algorithmic logics.
Yeah.
You do.
And before that, these were the inspectors at the airport. The algorithm was in there, right? Whatever, good or bad.
Yeah. Oh, no. So yes, it is true. We have profiling is not new. Yeah. Profiling is not new. The ingestion, and by the way, when I say this, I sound like I'm using a pejorative term. That's their term. The ingestion of entire databases that we use to orchestrate our ordinary life, right? That's new. And in part, one of the things that we need to kind of keep in mind as we have our ordinary lives interrogated in a way that they were never before, right? Which is not to say it's good that individual officer at border says, yeah, I don't like the look of you. I don't like the look of you because of your color, because of your hair, because of what I suspect you really. Yeah, okay, so here we go, right? So that personal prejudice, again, is not something that we want to say, see, that's what we want to go back to. right? The problem is that in terms of using all of the indicia of our everyday life in order to make these assessments, not only do we compromise the privacy of all of that data, right? Because we do, but we have to ask ourselves, at the point that we are doing such a thing, ostensibly for national security, geez, I wonder if we should even know if it works.
Exactly.
Because clearly, we are hurting some people.
Probably not.
Right? We are hurting some people. Who are we hurting? We know in a profiling context who we're hurting, right? Who is most impacted by the no-fly and the slow-fly list in Canada? Muslims. Clearly. When we look at things like, not exclusively, but a disproportionate impact, absolutely. So when we look at something like, and this exists, there's an organization called the No-Fly Kids. These are children who have been on lists since they were born, right? Now clearly, or we think clearly, they must have the wrong people, right? No four-month-old should be on the no-fly list. Right? They've got something wrong here. But the failure to get any appropriate redress for these people, as their parents watch shockingly, one, their children grow up trying to explain to them what's happened here. And again, not exclusively Muslim, but very disproportionately Muslim. Right? What's happened here, and many of them are aging out. Right? So they're 15 when this first starts happening, but the minute they're 18, they don't even have their parents there as an intermediary. And by the by, you're supposed to have photo ID and you're on your own relative to your ability to fly through the world, right? So you prejudice people, you hurt people by profiling them, you make entire communities distrust the agents of government, right? And in this case, in the context of what we're talking about right now, the Canadian government has as a piece of what it wants to do reaching out to specific communities to do programs for de-radicalization, right? So if somebody is vulnerable or at risk of being radicalized to violence, they want to do social and educative interventions. Now, what does that look like if you are doing that in the very communities that you're profiling? It's not very likely, right? How are you going to trust us if, by the by, we're profiling the heck out of you, right? So profiling is a form of, essentially, it's like organized discrimination. Unless, of course, you say, and many people do, well, unless it works, right? Well, I'm glad you say it's obvious. Happily, or I was going to say, you know, I don't know if it's exactly happily. Happily, we do actually have the data to back that up. If somebody is doesn't think it's obvious. In the national security context, we actually have amazing data. We have amazing data going up to some of the most high-level security experts globally. And the thing that they're clear about is, if you're running a screening algorithm for something as vanishingly rare in Canada as a terrorist, or even somebody who is a serious criminal, you cannot get any accuracy out of your program, no matter how much data you pile in, because you run up against the base rate fallacy. You simply do not have a high enough incidence to appropriately screen for it. You will get false positives and false negatives, and you will not have the efficacy. The program cannot work. Well, it'll work as soon as we ingest all these other databases. It cannot work, right? So I think a really good analogy, and it's an analogy that appears in a European report, where they talk about what would happen if we did some age-related cancer screenings from birth, right? So as an example, breast cancer is age-related, right? The higher incidence very much correlate with age. So if you started screening at birth, the efficacy of your program would be garbage, right? Garbage. It's why we see, excuse me, why we see so much controversy about when they start programs to offer screening mammograms, right? Should it be 40? Should it be 50? Should it be 60? What does it matter? You would say, well, start at 30, right? Or 20 if you want to catch everything. No, you can't. Because again, if you're not actually within the catchment where you have a high enough incidence, the screening becomes counterproductive. And what you're screening for, you can't effectively screen for it. You have no efficacy to your program. You have to find the catchment where you have a high enough incident. And in Canada, and indeed most of the world, terrorist incidents will never allow you to do effective screening. So the profiling that we're doing is highly problematic because it's clearly announced to a discriminatory response, certainly to individuals and absolutely to some communities. In addition to which, as far as we can tell, we are getting no security bang for our buck. None. So part of the discussion that we have in light of, well, we know all our security agencies are going gaga for bulk data. What are they doing with it? Profiling. That's what they're doing with it. This is raw material for exactly the kind of data analytics that currently we have no reason to believe work. But clearly imperil privacy and security of the individuals whose information is now willy-nilly gathered into these large databanks. So it's one aspect of some of the things that we're concerned about.
So if it doesn't work, why are they doing it?
Well,
because everybody else is doing it?
In part because everybody else is doing it. I was really, 2016 has been an amazing year for me. One of the most exciting things I got to do was talk to Edward Snowden this year. It was very exciting. It was fantastically exciting. And one of the things I got to ask him was that question, which is essentially, I've read the reports, everywhere you go, it's pretty clear, top security advisors say it doesn't work, why did they do it? And his answer was power. Power. So it certainly doesn't tell you very much about who's going to commit a terrorist act, but it certainly tells you a lot about the whole general population, right? You have a tremendous amount of power when you have that level of data. So imagine when you look at something, this is old news now, but it's still an example that I like to think of. Remember the Senate payment scandal, right? Who was paying who and who wrote the check and who knew about what? Remember, that was a major scandal in Canadian politics. And you say, well, I don't want to know who said anything. I just want the metadata. Who called who? From where? For how long? Or what time? What would that tell you about that story? Really everything you need to know, right? It's a tremendous amount of power. So that's without question. Again, are there true believers within the scenario saying, well, you know, I don't care what the math says. I'm sure if we crunch enough data, we're gonna get some safety benefit. But in the main, I think we can't doubt that the democratic concern is just how much power you have, knowing that much about everybody.
The other aspect of that is responsibility. I mean, if it totally screws up, you can't put a computer algorithm in jail.
Oh, you know, this is one of the most sort of interesting aspects of where we are at in terms of how we go about decision making, right? So exactly your point. What happens when the algorithm says, yeah, you can't fly? So you have a right in Canada. You have a right to life, liberty, and security. Person, you have mobility rights. You're allowed to leave the country. The government always says you have no right to be on a plane. And I think that there's a real problem with framing it that way. The government has no right to keep you off a plane unless they have constitutional justification. So the question is not, are you allowed to get on the plane? The question is, does the government have constitutional justification? So let's say you want to challenge it. And you say, I don't think you've got the correct grounds. You don't have grounds. And they say, well, the computer said we do. Well, and what's inside there, right? Shake this up, right? A few years ago, I got to attend a workshop called the Politics of Surveillance Workshop. And it was fascinating because there was a group of Canadian and international privacy lawyers. And there were some very heavy computer scientists who build algorithms, right? And they must have thought we were talking like three-year-olds. Because we were saying things to them like, how do I turn the computer upside down and shake it out so it can tell me how it's making the decisions, right? Well, they're laughing, right? They're totally laughing. Nobody can tell you that, right? Especially with self-learning systems. So if they are self-learning and their iterations are such that you essentially can't reverse engineer that to figure out what the heck they're deciding anything on. And so you say, so you're telling me there's no way to interrogate the algorithm. And if my right depends on a decision the government makes about me that is algorithmically based, we can't query that, right? Well, what happens to this thing that we have constitutionally called due process rights, right? How do you prove that you have due process, that they have grounds, that there's legitimacy there, that there's proportionality there? All of the things that you would check if you were checking, again, if we were having a court case or a tribunal or negotiation in which I made a decision about you, and you or your lawyer says, well, what were your grounds? And I'll go, well, here, this document here, and I made this decision, and I did this and that and the other thing. You would be able to challenge that. And it would be your due process rights to be able to. What are we going to do as we continue to automate through this, again, this interrogation proof methodology that we have every reason to believe is not accurate for the purposes for which we're told it's for? Right? These are big problems, right? These are really big problems.
It should be turned around. It should be automatically wrong until proven correct.
Well, I mean, one of the things, you could very much make the argument, I think, again, part of what really inhibits us here is how much of this whole operation occurs in the shadows, right? Again, we didn't even know about CSIS illegally collecting the metadata. It's been 10 years to figure that out. 10 years of not telling the court quite what it needed to hear to figure that portion out. When the court did hear it, it said, you can't do that, that's illegal. Meanwhile, we have 10 years worth of data collection, and what the minister has said so far about that, because that's sitting there in a database, is, well, let's not be too hasty. Because, of course, you could say, how about press the delete button right here and now?
Easy to do.
Easy to do. No, it hasn't happened.
No.
Right? So you get this sense.
Why do you say that? It can hurt you too. Because CCC is good with the data they have. They can pursue or chase certain politicians
yes.
to affect elections or whatever, mm-hmm. in jail for whatever reason. Mm. According to their interest, which is not the public, they're not public figures, they're
yes.
elected. And the minister could be one of those.
Mm-hmm.
So it should have been his interest to delete his data because there might be some illegal information about
right.
him within these databases.
It's possible. The problem when you are the minister, or indeed any elected official, is no matter how crazy pants the policy, the legislation, the powers that you've given to national security, you know that your political enemies, when you say, no, that's ridiculous, let's pull that back, the next thing that happens in the world, something will happen, will be blamed on the fact that you did that. Your political enemies will line up and say, if you hadn't done that, that train wouldn't have exploded. You're responsible. So in terms of political accountability, it is very difficult to find the political courage to roll back even stuff that you believe should never have happened. Because the political price for that will be very extreme, and your political opposition or enemies will make very great hay of that. So that's part of the problem. And again, this is the nature of the politics of this is such that we see very little pulling back. what we see is government increasing the powers, their own state powers of national security, every time there's an international incident or a local incident that gives them the momentum, right? So there was a terrorist incident that saw immediately following that the introduction of Bill C-51. And they said, this is in response to this, the shooting at Parliament. And we often see this. This is, you know, how many things come forward, right? They lurch forward with that. And initially, they did some polling. And the public response, again, attached to a recent incident, overwhelming 81% of people polled said, bring it on. Yes, I am in favor of this. Within 3 weeks, and people actually reading what was in it, the majority of people polled said they were against it. But again, this idea of having it harnessed to events in which people, you are very hard pressed to find people who don't want to see, very well meaning, right? They want to see an answer to this. Fix this. A terrible thing has happened in the world. Fix it. So there's a great momentum to move forward, but you have to have a lot of political courage to pull back once you've reached that new place. And it's part of the momentum that we see around national security, which is quite often described as we have to find the appropriate balance. I've been watching this since 9/11. I've seen that indicator move farther and farther from what would be considered the balance. Essentially, we've been rebalancing more and more extreme all the time. And the politics of how we address this is very difficult. But one of the aspects I think, I don't know, is there such a thing called the digital community? People who are interested in digital privacy have been very vocal, much more vocal than I think the government had anticipated. Many of the people who came out to some of those thousands of people in the streets protests, they really seem to have two primary complaints about Bill C-51. Their top of the pops concerns were CSIS were given special new powers of disruption, so they would operate an awful lot like a secret police. I still have not met anybody who's in favor of this. But also, many, many people were very concerned about the surveillance powers that were very much expanded in Bill C-51. And again, this runs counter to very much what the government thinks. I think in the main, government believes that people don't care about privacy. They really don't. Everybody uses digital everything, ergo, how could you care about privacy, right? And I think it's always very interesting how much and how well organized using digital communication tools to get the message out and up and off to Parliament. We have, as far as we know, they say over 45,000 submissions on the National Security Consultation. That's, again, remembering, this is pretty arcane stuff, right? You know, this is not about, you know, I don't know, like parking tickets or something that everybody gets riled about, right? Everybody has an experience of, everybody knows this, about snow plows or something that everybody, you know, this is about national security framework. For many people, this must seem quite obscure. 45,000 and counting is a tremendous, tremendous show of interest in these subjects, I think. So, do you have, again, other particular concerns? Because really, I can talk about this for a long time. And I want to make sure that I'm kind of pulling in where your particular interest might be. Yes?
If I summarize everything you said, yes, you're saying that the situation is bad.
Yes.
What can we do about it? I have the impression we can't do anything.
Well, one of the things, again, and I realize the window for this is closing, is to tell the government that we care, right? Make it hard for them to just carry on. The kinds of things that they seem very interested in doing, which would certainly assist, but in our view are wildly inadequate. They would like, for example, to have Canada catch up. Canada is way, way, way behind in accountability on national security. And we always think, because we're Canadians, right? Canada the good, Canada peace, order, and good government. Surely we've got all of our T's crossed on this. And in fact, the Americans have much better national security oversight than we do. Every one of the Five Eyes, which is the intelligence partnership that encompasses the US, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and the UK, everybody has better oversight than we do. We have archaic medieval oversight. And so it has not been difficult for the government to say, well, let's get some of those accountability pieces that other places have. So it seems pretty clear that we're going to get a parliamentary committee, for example, that has some powers of oversight over these agents. It might strike you as hard to believe that we have no parliamentary committee that looks at these things, but we don't, right? It sounds shocking, we don't. So having one would be better than not having one, presumably. But I can tell you that the bill that is currently before the government as to what that committee would look like would create a very toothless watchdog. Very toothless. In essence, tell me how you think this is going to work. The committee investigates departments that will tell the committee what information they may have about the departments. Yeah, it's not going to work great, is it? No. So, the kinds of pressure that we can exert would include things like accountability has to be real, right? I mean, we're not going to give up on the worst parts of this, but the parts where the government wants to go forward, and they do want to go forward. They want to be able to say we have addressed accountability. And a very meaningful place to put pressure is to say that's got to be real and not pretend. Will that fix all of our problems? No. But it will give us some more tools for fixing our problems.
I was going to ask about security emergencies for the committee.
Oh, yes. Well, of course, the very departments that you'll be investigating will be providing those security clearances. Yeah, it's very clear that there will be all kinds of veto powers available that would prevent the committee from getting necessary and relevant information. Just one of the problems with the committee as it's currently configured. I mean, we could do better. The UK originally had a committee very much like what's being proposed in Canada and has just reformed their committee because they found out it doesn't work very well. We would like to skip over the 3 years of finding out it doesn't work very well. How about we go right to fix it? That's one of our proposals. But certainly, I think, you know, when you look at this and you say, I mean, part of what ends up, you almost invariably have to invoke Kafka, because there's no way to get around it. You're dealing with something that is so bizarre because of the element of secrecy. One of the very high-ranking lawyers within the ACLU, the American Civil Liberties Union, who has since left for an academic job, but for many, many years was heading up their national security division at the ACLU. A lovely Canadian lawyer named Jamil Jaffer, very smart. And he talked about how bizarre it was. They had a court case where they were trying to appear before the secret court that looks at warrants for the NSA. Okay, so there's a secret court. We don't have a secret court. We have ministerial directives that are also secret. But one guy, not even a court, not even a, right? Again, Canada, we think it's better, it's not. So they've got this secret court, and he has to make a submission to the secret court, except it's a secret where the secret court is. And I'm not making that up, right? there you are, a lawyer who needs to make a submission to the secret court, and you cannot find out where the secret court is, because it's a secret, right? This is the level of, no, surely that is not the system that you're in constantly. And so one of the things that happens, and we, again, we have seen this time and time again, where you have not just the distinction that I was trying to make between secret operations, but you have, in effect, secret laws. So you remember when the head of the NSA was testifying before Congress and was asked, right, do you collect the information of millions of Americans? Remember that answer? No, sir. Okay. So what did that answer hinge on? It hinged on a secret legal interpretation about what the word collect means. Horrible. Have we seen a similar interpretation in Canada? We certainly have. How many of those secret interpretations? I don't know. But I can tell you we found one in the most recent CERC report. Again, the same CERC report that was looking at CSIS bulk data. So CSIS bulk data, and again, they're reporting on this in their public report. They don't tell us, again, which is which and what's what. But they start by saying, well, in CSIS's interpretation of the act, right, if something is publicly available and openly sourced, and they take it, it's not collection.
But isn't correlation collect here is sort of something that's open, different, you know, it's there, it's public, but it's a correlating that?
Well, again, there is nothing in the CSIS Act that would support that interpretation. They've completely made it up. They've completely made up this interpretation. We say that if it is this, it's not collection for the purposes of the Act. Did anybody who enacted the Act say that? Did anyone of the legislatures who designed this Act say that? No, we've just interpreted it as such and had this secret interpretation for many years until CERC outed us on it, right? So, collection that isn't collection, the meaning of relevant, right? All of these kinds of things have turned out to be vast repositories for what turns out to be secret laws. So you may have very well-meaning lawmakers saying, you know, we have drafted this. In fact, the people who drafted the revisions to the Patriot Act were among those people. And they said, we put in the term relevant so that they could not willy-nilly go gathering bulk data. Well, that's what they thought they meant, but it was interpreted otherwise. So again, if your secret interpretation takes 10 years to come to light, right, what kind of accountability mechanism do you have? And then the further thing that happens is, because it takes so much political courage to say, hey, you've been doing this wrong, better not collect that data, better rein you in. Typically what happens is when these things are discovered, they simply change the law to allow them. So yesterday's law breaking becomes today's law abiding.
Considering what just happened in England and in Australia, you know, if the watchdog says you can't do that, they change the law so that they can.
Right, and so one of the points that we've made is law-breaking as law reform is a sure way to erode public trust.
Absolutely.
Yeah, but what about constitution? Constitution is above the law, right?
No. Nothing is above the law. And so the whole point here is it's something that we call the rule of law. Nothing is above the law. That's the rule. Because if something were above the law, we wouldn't be working in a democracy.
So decide on something that makes it morally correct and justified and right. So the government, the legislative authority, they decide what is right and what is wrong. And there is no, if they decide that white people, which is taller than 6'5", are not allowed to have apartments in a high-rise building, they could make that law for whatever reason, that would be acceptable.
No.
Because, no, why not?
It would not be acceptable in a constitutional democracy where the Constitution is the highest law.
Yeah, not the case in Canada, or
is it? It is. We have a constitution.
Oh, so we do have a constitution.
Yes.
It is about the law.
Yes.
So where is it when it comes to privacy?
Well,
because you say we're changing the law.
Yes. Well, now, this is a very interesting question. It happens to be something we know a lot about at the BC Civil Liberties Association, because we are in the midst of a constitutional challenge to an aspect of the national security framework. So our version of the NSA is the CSE. We used to refer to it as CSEC, but now, yeah. Okay, so the CSE, I still think of it as CSEC. That is our signals intelligence. Our signals intelligence entity. We say that they are operating unconstitutionally. And so we have taken the CSE to court. Now, this is where it gets tricky. They're a national security agency. If they were a different kind of agency, we'd be having a very different court case. But what happens in court is we say, when you get there, you've got to make what's called discovery, you gotta make disclosure, right? Here's our case, here are all the relevant documents. And they say, no relevant documents from us, they're all secret. Well, you say, well, yeah, but we gotta have this court case, we gotta figure out if you're following the law. And they say, catch us.
Yeah, but if I have a conflict with you and you go to court and I don't show up, then the judge will rule for you.
Right, but when you're in court and the government entity that you are in opposition to in terms of the litigation, there is something called the Canada Evidence Act. And Section 38 of the Canada Evidence Act will allow them to keep certain aspects of this court proceeding, information that's relevant to it, secret. So it's pretty difficult because you're in a secret court.
They are pursuing it because they can't.
I'll tell you some of the things that we've done. There are some of the things that I can't tell you about what we've done in this context because, again, it's secret. But there are mechanisms that we have tried to shape. So one of the things that we've done, and we find this in various aspects of national security proceedings, where the party that is a party to the litigation doesn't get their lawyer to go into the courtroom. There are special security-cleared lawyers who act as friends of the court or special advocates to the person who is not allowed to be in the room to do a kind of a triangulation, right? They can hear the secret evidence, but they can't tell you the secret evidence, but they can act sort of on your behalf, but you can't really instruct them very well. This is one way that they try to protect national security privilege. But again, you look at the rights of the people who are involved in trying to be part of this process, they're clearly curtailed. So no question you're fighting with one hand behind your back. But ultimately, even though this secrecy shrouds much, ultimately at the end of the day, if we win, they will have to change the aspects that we think don't meet the constitutional standard. I'm just saying, we have challenges that nobody else has in something that isn't national security consultation litigation implicated because of that shroud of secrecy. But ultimately, yes, they do have to abide by the law. There's a very important case, and it's probably the best illustration of what it means, or one aspect of what we call the rule of law. The rule of law. And it was a very seminal case in Canada called Ron Corelli and Duplessis. And it had to do with a premier of Quebec. Do you know this one? Okay, yes. He was famous for his religious persecution. And he had a political enemy or somebody he didn't like who had posted bail for a bunch of people who had been arbitrarily arrested. And he had acted in support of them. He was an activist and a humanitarian who acted for them. And so, his name was Ron Corelli. And so Duplessis revoked his liquor license because he was a restaurateur. It's like, well, I'll just hurt you then. I'll just hurt you, right? And that case was one of the, again, seminal, important cases in Canada to say, no, arbitrary power is not what you have here. You must follow the law. It was irrelevant and arbitrary that you did this action. And you cannot exercise your power in that way because it is a breach of what we call the rule of law, right? So that's one aspect you say, well, you got the power. It's like, yet you can't do everything with it. It must be within the law. And that's what we mean about having the rule of law. And you can understand the challenges of trying to ensure that that's what's happening in the national security realm, because you almost never get to pull back the curtain to see what's going on. You do you, you, me too.
And, you know, they always say, well, we're acting within the law. But it's like, I'm wondering how old those laws are. Like, the whole notion of signals and intelligence goes back to World War II. And I don't think a lot of it has been updated. Well, C-51. But it's like, I'm just wondering how old some of that is and how outdated it is. And if you know what laws they're thinking.
And that's so often the case, right? We're acting within the laws. What is your interpretation of the laws? How do you classify the kinds of things that we really didn't classify before? What do you consider metadata? Do you consider that personal information? Because if it's personal information, it receives a kind of privacy protection that is dependent on the classification. So these kinds of questions, really getting into the weeds, are going to tell us whether or not we agree on whether you're working within the law, right? And those are the kinds of things that are like pulling teeth to figure out. And having the agencies, be it expert review, like the commissioner of the CSE, right? Who goes in and looks around and see, you know, kicks the tires and bangs things around and say what's in here and what's in there. Those expert review bodies are critical. Parliamentary oversight that has real teeth. One of the things that the UK has that we would like to see here is they have an independent monitor. And what they are monitoring are legislation, national security legislation, and advising the government and issuing reports on legislation in relation to national security. So, you know, it's really sort of a multi-tiered accountability framework that we would be looking at. But in part, one of the things that we've said sort of plaintively, because it sounds so ridiculous to actually have to say this, is we would like to see you actually enforce the laws and not simply reward national security agencies for breaking the laws by granting them ever greater powers every time they're discovered to have done so. So, and again, I think it's quite surprising for Canadians, because we always feel, you know, we probably do these things better than other places. This is one of the times when we are really wrong about that. Really, really wrong. Yeah.
Is it possible to make it personal? Like, make the commissioner of CSIS responsible for CSIS and put him on trial?
Well, you know, one of the most shocking things, and you would only know it was shocking if you know the language of the court. The federal court that heard the CSIS case said the breach of duty of candor for 10 years. That's not the first time CSIS has been found to breach their duty of candor, by the way. But the 10 years running. The judge in that case, it's a very long decision, it's over 100 pages. But somewhere in the mid section of it, excuse me. He has this cry, you never hear judges say this, where he says, what's it going to take? Do we need to prosecute for contempt of court with all the consequences that will flow from that? Right? Again, this is a court that is traditionally very deferential to national security. For the judge to have reached that point to say that, and again, it doesn't sound like the kind of, you know, hissing and swearing that you might hear on the bus. But that is a very extraordinary statement to find within a judgment. And so you are not the only person who's asking this question. Federal court judges have asked it publicly. Yeah.
There are also ways to render all these systems useless with very simple technical ways mm-hmm. that are done by individuals. I talk about three ways. One is not actually mine. It's a very done in Venice in the 15th century, in fact, in the Renaissance. Just copied the masks. Okay, so you render face recognition useless anywhere you go. Public appearances and all pictures for ID or whatever, and then think, mm-hmm. fine, that's not the
right.
That's very that's not in consideration or whatever. Mm-hmm. It's very it's not very popular to discuss about it with your face. But no, not that. Just when you walk in the street and cover your face, mm-hmm. which have been done in history in many occasions, then you render many of the systems useless. Mm-hmm. I saw yesterday, I think, on the Kickstarter some project for glasses, eyeglasses that are actually making all the cameras, video cameras, video surveillance cameras useless if you can't see through the eyes. But you don't need just put a mask. I believe it will be a common and public practice done. Another way is if I send you, or if I converge with you and then we decide to flood the system, we start to exchange email between us regarding terrorism, how we are going to put a bomb here and there, and the Service Canada office on this street is open at these hours, put the bomb on this, I don't know if that's what happens, so. Put the bomb on this garbage bin or so, or whatever, on a bus, and obviously the system is going to catch it within seconds, and it can start chasing us, but you're not going to get anything because you and I are just doing it for fun.
Right.
And another thing is in the airports, which was, to me it was obvious that the authorities are following internet communication on free Wi-Fi in airports. Just go in an airport and say, yeah, this airplane 4X VC-Y, which is the license for the airplane, is landing on runway so-and-so at this time. It doesn't have to be real. It just needs to be like sounds like a professional language. And obviously the algorithm will catch it in seconds. And if many people will do it, then many people will be on the no-fly list, even though a no-fly list has nothing to do with it.
Right.
No-fly list, if you pass security, you have to go all the way or not, and that's it.
Yeah.
It doesn't matter what you know in your personal
life. Right.
Then it will be made very ridiculous.
Right.
But these tricks are very simple tricks. They happen in quantities that they will blind the system in minutes, I think.
Yeah.
It depends how many people are going to do it. And I'm sure there are many more ways, very simple ways. And then you will be unemployed.
Well, you know, I could work in a bookstore and be very happy, I assure you. Well, I'll tell you, I mean, certainly you could imagine people, even as a protest, making some kind of statement of a kind. Yeah, it is civil disobedience, and it would be very challenging. I'm thinking about a situation in which, by the by, it just went to the Supreme Court of Canada, the question about having to register as an election advertiser if you were talking about anything that any politician is talking about during the election period of a provincial government in British Columbia. So you know that there are caps on election advertising, for example, but British Columbia is in a very strange position, one which we violently oppose, not violently in terms of our means, but in terms of how we're staunchly opposed, that there is no basement. So the question is ceiling, putting a cap on what you can spend, but there's no basement. So if you crayon onto a piece of cardboard you find in the alley, and you say, something about the environment, you're supposed to register as an election advertiser in British Columbia if that's happening during the election period. And people say, no, that can't be the law. It's like, no, that actually is the law. You have to register your speech with the government. Okay, so you can imagine from a free speech democratic standpoint, this is terrible. And one of the things that was tried was essentially a program of what would be civil obedience. What would happen if everyone who actually did that registered, right? Okay, let's do it. Let's get every British Columbian to register. And of course, it will simply make the point about the meaninglessness. And so I think that in conception, that was a very, very good, like, as I say, not civil disobedience, but civil obedience, right? Civil obedience. But it is tremendously resource intensive, right? To mobilize huge groups of people and do these things, you are looking at a lot of people's lifeblood, hours and hours and hours, energy and energy and energy that really could be spent elsewise. So, as I say, even as expressive activity to put together something that would constitute a statement of some kind is not price free. Not price free. So one of the things that I think before we kind of put a wrap on stuff, there was a couple of things that I did want to tell you that the government was really interested in looking at that are not part of our current national security framework, but part of those digital investigation powers that the police have been calling for. So one aspect of that is a reigniting of the long-standing lawful access debate about what is called basic subscriber information. So telecommunications, service providers, customer information in relation to name, address, email, IP address, EMC, whatever, right? Little catchment, like I can't remember exactly how many data items within that. Whether, because we've already gone to the Supreme Court of Canada on this one just recently, or in 2014, the Spencer case, Supreme Court of Canada said, information allows you to put together a very rich profile of where a person has been on the internet. It requires that you give it the legal standing of information that you have, or rather, it is information in which you have a reasonable expectation of privacy. So the question has been, well, what that we know what that means on one end. We know that that means the police shouldn't get it just for asking. You have a reasonable expectation of privacy in that. But what would be the appropriate protection is now what's up for grabs. Most privacy advocates say, we have a way to make this happen. It's called a warrant. Go get one, right? Of course you should have this information if you've got the justification and you meet the legal standard. Go to the judge, get the warrant, take it away. The police haven't said exactly what they're looking for, but they would like some kind of warrant regime that looks like it doesn't involve a court, which probably means some police officer telling another police officer that that's okay. An administrative warrant process. And you'll be unsurprised to hear that we say that's not good enough. So that's one aspect of the digital investigations powers. The other one that's causing a lot of discussion right now is the potential ability, the proposed ability to be able to get a court order to order someone to be able to provide their password or decrypt their information. And I think what this is reflecting is the growing understanding that building back doors into systems is hopeless from the point of security. I really think, maybe this is just wishful thinking, I don't know, but there's kind of a sense of the government sort of getting that part. It's like, yes, government security people are not keen on back doors because it's bad for security. So the sense of, okay, well, if that's not going to work, what could? And so this notion of, well, maybe we could get a court order, not compromise everybody's security by building in back doors, but actually targeting the person that we're actually targeting. Now, there is already the ability to get an assistance order that goes with a warrant. So if you're the ISP and I have a warrant for some of your customers' information, I can also get an assistance order that says, hi, you actually have to help me with this, right? So it's not really something that impacts third parties. But if I show up and I have a warrant for your information, yours, not your customers, and I say, oh yeah, and by the by, oh, this looks encrypted, you better give me the password. If you're gonna provide that to me, you're incriminating yourself. You have a right against self-incrimination, right? So how exactly that's gonna work is unclear. But one of the things that we've said is, well, certainly in the regular criminal law, this is a problem. But we know from the way that the court has interpreted these matters that you have a lower expectation of privacy at the border. And CBSA has been arresting people for obstruction who are not providing their passwords for devices that they want to get into. And we had thought last year that we were going to see a court case that was going to tell us whether it was constitutional, again, the rule of law, the higher law, whether it was constitutional for them to arrest somebody who didn't provide their password. Unfortunately, that case settled. Originally, the accused was very adamant that they were going to do a charter challenge, and it didn't transpire. So that would give us some guidance. But in the meantime, while we're waiting for some of these other cases to be heard and decisions to hear what the court has to say, the government is sounding out a possible proposal that would be much broader than the border context and could be just part of the regular criminal law. We think they're going to have trouble constitutionally. Yeah.
You know, it's like similar to this. I heard, Governor Olson from the RCMP.
Yeah, that's right.
So he was talking about how not only at the would ISPs have to fork over passwords, but they would have to keep a log of all the websites that you visited. Okay, and it's like, you know, he said with a warrant we could go in and get your web history. This is everything. Now I appreciate that he doesn't have. He's not an especially tech savvy person.
Right.
Okay? But the people who were advising him. Okay, I mean, it's like it's your web history and my web history and everybody else's web history, but we're just ordinary folks. The bad guys would know how to use a proxy, a middleman. Okay, and it's like they're just going to go, you know, I want to go to server C, well, I'll go via server B.
Yeah,
and it's like I'm using an encrypted connection, and you'll never know what traffic I used, and you know, that sort of thing. And it's like it amazes me that the people who are making the decisions have such a shallow grasp of technology, and their advisors as well. You know, so you know, the notion of what a future internet will look like. You know, it's almost like a secret police. I mean,
Well,
you know, it's just increasingly broken.
I don't think there's any doubt about that. I mean, one of the things that they're floating in the paper is data retention, right? Data retention. Of course, data retention is dire from the perspective, again, of security, right? One of the first data protection principles is once you're finished with it for a business use, get rid of it because it's a liability, security liability after that. How do you protect data in those quantities? When they talk about data retention, what they're saying is we would like telecommunication service providers to hang on to data just in case, because we'll turn the presumption of innocence on its head and start by the prospect that you may be guilty of something. Ergo, we need to hang on to your data. Everybody, population-wise. And you know, it's not even a situation where we don't have tools for if the police are short of time, right? So if I'm a police officer and I go, oh my God, I don't know what their retention schedule is, am I going to have time to get a warrant? I whap in there on the lowest possible standard with a protection order to say, hang on to it, right? I'll be back with a warrant, right? You just freeze it. You have that tool. No, we're going to consider freezing everything. And again, what does that say about the society that we're in, and that it's sort of suggested in such, benign terms, right? We're worried that we won't catch the bad guy. We might miss somebody. So it would just be better if we held all of your data hostage, right? Again, huge security liability and the implications for, again, your potential guilt as ordinary citizen, right? You can't look at those proposals and say, we're sliding down that slope very quickly in ways that should really concern us. And to your point about what happened in Britain, I don't know if people are aware. I am certainly aware because it was Privacy International who brought this court challenge. Again, the rule of law, here we go. The human rights law governing in the UK, at least at the moment, we'll see what happens later, found that virtually all of the population-based surveillance of the intelligence agents in the UK was illegal. And very quickly, new law just wipes out that years of advocacy and court work and research and everything else that was needed to make that case. You just change the law. And again, it becomes very difficult to say, well, I mean, by my read, that same case with the new law would have the same finding. But you'd have to start again. And it's, again, it's very, very labor intensive. But there's been a lot of trying to play catch up, because the security agencies are doing things that we don't know about. When we find out about them, the laws change. We need to get a charter challenge in there to actually, again, bring some aspect of an adjudication about the rule of law. Are we operating within that scheme? By which point, you could be dealing with a set of facts that are already 5 years old and God knows what they're doing now, right? You're always playing this game of catch up. And again, it's dispiriting, but it doesn't mean that the work isn't worth doing. Because in the sunniest side up, we want people to have confidence that our national security agencies are working for us. Right? That they're doing the job within the law, they're doing things that are necessary and proportionate and responsible and protect our rights. That would be good. In the worst case scenario, of course, everybody's talking about this all over the world. You'd sound like a conspiracy theory in a nut bar if you were to mention this even a few short years ago. But in the worst case scenario, you're talking about a shadow government, right? This is the question. What's going on back there? Who's pulling the levers? What are you doing? Is it lawful? And is it democratic, right? We're having a whole global discussion right now about who's pulling the strings in the last US election. I don't know. I don't even have a theory. But the fact that this is front page news should give us some sense of what the worst case scenario is about what a shadow government can do.
There's a sense in which, like, for example, in the United States, I understand that the CIA provides certain data, certain kinds of data to big business. Mm-hmm. That's part of its mandate to support or mm-hmm. American.
Yeah.
So presumably, the oil companies in New York get mm-hmm. security briefings about the Middle East.
Yeah.
So it occurs to me that a lot of this data, right, has a market, an extra market. So it's like a shadow government and a shadow economy.
Well, that's interesting. I mean, one of the things that we learned very early on, when was Echelon, for gosh sakes? We're going way back. That one of the first things we found out about it was being used for economic espionage, right? we kind of forget that all the time, get wrapped up in some other information, but there's no doubt about it. And clearly, this, you know, some of the Snowden revelations that pertained especially to Canada had to do with Canadian mining interests. Right? And again, that shouldn't surprise us. This is the part of what we know, and that it's part of what we need to be concerned about. Right.
Mr. A. Vonn. Okay, so he's advocating for violence. Mm-hmm. Okay? Charismatic leader advocates for violence. What is meant by violence? Is he advocating that people study martial arts? Mm-hmm. Is he advocating that people run a wildcat strike? Is he, you know, what is meant by violence? And it's like, is the consultation, the language of consultation overly vague?
Well, I'm not sure. So the question about whether the language of the consultation is overly vague, they certainly have cherry-picked their scenarios, and you encounter all kinds of questions about the meaning of words, which, again, is very national security in terms of its focus. Right? What do we mean by that word? One of the places that I can recall thinking that the paper was most problematic, to give you an example, talking about how they frame, let's just walk through a scenario, right? The scenario that they walk through in relation to the no-fly list seems to indicate that the worst thing that can happen to you is that you're irksomely delayed, right? This is not the worst thing that can happen to you. The worst thing that can happen to you is that you are abroad. You are put on the no-fly list, and you cannot come home. And the country you are trying to get out of now has you flagged as a potential terrorist. And your life and security is at peril, and the Canadian government has put you there. In fact, what we know about what happens sometimes in the US is that there have been cases that the ACLU has talked about. We don't know how broad spread this practice is, but we have no reason to think it is a one-off, where they send members of the CIA and the FBI abroad to question that person who has been put on the no-fly list while they're out of town and say, hey, if you'd like to be an informant for us, we could get you on an airplane, no problem. Right? So as leverage for informants, and presumably if you'd like to bring them into your fold as a potential informant, and happily put them on a plane to do so, that they were no security threat on that airplane to begin with. Right? So if we had been selecting the scenarios, they would have looked quite different. And again, the question is, you know, are we responsibly painting the portrait of what happens when people's rights in the national security realm, people's human rights in the national security realm. You know, we have to talk about things like torture, because that's what happens in the national security realm. We've had three major inquiries in Canada on national security issues, two having to do with Canadians rendered to torture. So again, when we talk about, well, what's at stake? What's the jeopardy here? People would say the stakes in national security are very high. Somebody blows up a train, it doesn't get too much higher. On the other hand, the stakes to human security of when national security goes wrong are also astronomically high. And so it's very important that we have confidence that we've got the rules right. And I am pretty convinced that it is a vanishingly small percentage of Canadians who think that we've got it right at the moment. Yeah. Well, are we good for a wrap? I've done a lot of talking.
You said that window that is closing on Wednesday.
So, yes, it is December 15th is the deadline for people making submissions to the National Security Consultation. If you go to our website, the BCCLA website, bccla.org, we've got a series of blogs that give you little bits and pieces of things that you might want to know to participate, but also we'll show you, it's like, yeah, here's the email address. If torture is your issue, here, take this paragraph, cut and paste, put it into this email, and press send. Boom. As an example. But you can say whatever you want. You can say, hey, I think you got it right here, or I don't think you got it right here, or hats off to you on this one. And
what is it? What is the National Security Consultation?
Yes.
What is it?
It's the government taking in information in a bunch of different ways. One is the online, there's an online form. You can send in an email. They've had meetings across the country. They've had testimony by experts that they've grouped together to ask their opinions on certain specific legal or technical issues. So it's been a whole array of activity. But the actual being able to send something to the government, the opportunity ends December the 15th.
I expect that.
It will be very hard to know that they're actually going to cut something off, but they've already extended the deadline. It was originally December the 1st, and they made it December the 15th. So if you were hoping to, I would urge you to do that. Tomorrow would be great. We're getting in our big submission tomorrow. I've been working on it for a long time. And we're going to get it in just before the deadline, not a minute too early. Terrific.
And people have a couple of days to get to.
Good, so sounds good.
So on that note, I'd like to thank you very much.
Thank you. Thanks. Thank you. Nice to be here. Thanks.